we go. Focus. Speed. I am speed.
Like most kids born in the early 2000s and being force-fed Disney films since birth, I grew up watching the Cars trilogy. Love it or hate it, I'd be lying if I said that Cars wasn't my childhood, and probably played a part in me still being interested in actual cars in general. I still remember going back to school and talking to all my friends about the first Cars film, about how cool McQueen was, and hoping one day we could be like him. But if any of you still remember, the Cars trilogy wasn't exactly perfect. Sure, the original Cars was different, fresh, and new at the time, but Cars 2 just wasn't it. I think a large part of my interest in the franchise died after Cars 2, it being more of a spy film than a film actually about what Cars was supposed to be about, racing. It also didn't really help that it came out 5 years later, when the original audience of those watching Cars would have probably grown up a bit, and have a bit of knowledge on figuring out what films actually made something unique, and what films are just pandering to what is popular at the time. As a result, I don't even think I watched Cars 3 in the cinema when it released in 2017. But recently on TikTok, I came across a short clip of the trailer of Cars 3, and a sudden wave of nostalgia just came over me, so I decided to give Cars 3 another shot. And I gotta say, Cars 3 is a masterpiece. Cars 3 begins with iconic lines that every kid knew back in the day.
Here we go. Focus. Speed. I am speed.
Following that, we get a montage of McQueen in the near present, racing and winning. We see most of the old characters from the first film, and it's all fun and games. But in comes the rookie. Overall, just being a dick, to be honest.
Wow, thank you, Mr. McQueen. You have no idea what a pleasure it is for me to finally beat you.
Oh, thanks. Wait, hang on, did you say meet or beat?
I think you heard me.
I kinda understand why they made him so comically one-dimensional with absolutely no character development, but then again, I did hope for some more, but I digress. We get introduced to the specifics of Jackson Storm and the rest of the rookies, how they're faster, more aerodynamic, using high-tech training facilities with a similar montage from the first couple scenes. Except with Storm beating McQueen every single time. Slowly but surely, McQueen gets hit with the reality of the situation, until he's almost alone. Honestly, during this part, I was genuinely surprised that McQueen could keep up with the majority of the new gen racers through just his raw skill and experience over the others. But I guess his ego couldn't take it. And this scene genuinely hurt. Time passes and McQueen is obviously depressed. He lost his drive and his motivation, and well, as depressing and sad as the situation is, I feel like this is as realistic as the film gets. McQueen somehow gets a bit of his motivation back.
I've thought long and hard about it, done a lot of soul searching and considered all of the options, and I finally decided.
You do? Want to keep racing?
Are you kidding? Of course I want to keep racing!
Meanwhile, Rusty and Dusty are working on a huge training facility. One travel montage later, we're at the Rusty's training center. It's all great and all, until Rusty and Dusty break the news to McQueen.
We sold Rusty's!
Eh?
Although McQueen is obviously a bit shook, but I think this, along with the retirement from McQueen's friends, is just another sign of things moving out of McQueen's time. Sterling is introduced as McQueen's new billionaire sponsor, who I guess does care about McQueen's legacy. After McQueen gets suited up to fit the times, I can't help but feel like something's just a bit off. He certainly looks more modern, but it isn't the same McQueen that I knew and idolized back in the day. And I feel like it does symbolize that McQueen is trying to be something that he just isn't. Somehow they snuck a VR joke in there, and somehow it still applies in 2022.
Still working on that.
Even though the film released in 2017. We finally get introduced to the second lead in the film, Cruz Ramirez. And I still find her a bit annoying, but I guess that is her character. She still treats McQueen as an old guy, and to be fair, he is old. It's just, I guess cars don't really look like they age? I don't know. Anyway, McQueen obviously gets fed up and wants to try out the simulator, but then ends up breaking it because he's not used to the virtual track experience. As a result, Ramirez gets told off and McQueen is told by Sterling to retire. Weirdly enough, I thought that this scene, although it was harsh, wasn't exactly unrealistic. Racing teams are businesses after all, and winning is the best marketing and helps investors get interested. Every time McQueen loses, he does damage his image, and it won't be doing him any favors from Sterling's perspective. But as a racing enthusiast, I guess McQueen couldn't wrap his head around it. And for good reason.
I promise you, I will win.
I don't know. What you're asking, it's too risky.
Come on. You like it, I can tell. It's got that little comeback story of the year feel to it, doesn't it?
One race? If you don't win at Florida, you'll retire?
Look, if I don't win, I'll sell all the mud flaps you got. But if I do win, I decide when I'm done. Deal?
Deal.
After this exchange, McQueen gets offered one last deal, win or retire, but only if McQueen gets trained with Ramirez, and so McQueen's training arc begins. This time around, McQueen ends up babysitting Ramirez due to his experience on the field as opposed to inside a training center. After essentially wasting a day doing nothing but teach Ramirez the basics, McQueen decides to head to Thunder Hollow for a real race as some training, except he has to go incognito. Turns out the race isn't exactly a professional race. It's some knockout battle royale style race, and Ramirez somehow gets dragged into it as well. Due to sheer luck, they manage to survive to the end. But McQueen's identity gets exposed, and the entire world knows he's there racing in some small-time country dirt track, instead of being in Florida practicing the real thing. Because of this mishap, McQueen gets into an argument with Ramirez, and well, Ramirez reveals that she actually wanted to become a racer as a kid, but she was never given the opportunity ever, and thus had to resort to becoming a trainer despite her innate abilities.
But I was the fastest kid in town, and I was gonna prove them wrong.
What happened?
When I got to my first race, I figured it out.
What?
That I didn't belong.
Honestly, this is probably the least annoying Ramirez ever gets in the film, and gives her, I guess, a bit of character and depth from the overly optimistic and cheery character she was introduced as. That argument actually moved McQueen a bit, and decides to apologize to Ramirez and bring her along for the ride. Making their way to Thomasville, McQueen goes to look for Smokey, Doc's mentor, for some help. To their surprise, they meet the legends of racing, at least from back in Doc's day. This conversation was actually kinda nice. It was really realistic, to be honest, because the old timers didn't sugarcoat anything to McQueen.
Miss Nash, it's a pleasure to meet
you. You've had a tough year, haven't you?
Oh, well...
Shouldn't you be running practice laps in Florida by now?
Yeah, sure,
they're here to steal our secrets.
Looking for your lost mojo?
Wow. You don't mince words around here, do you? Truth is always quicker, kid.
McQueen then gets shown letters from Doc to Smokey about himself and realizes that coaching was actually Doc's passion. This serves as an interesting way for foreshadowing McQueen's eventual actions, but honestly I didn't really pay attention to it the first time I saw it. I guess this training arc was sort of an homage to Doc training McQueen back in the day with older, more rusty techniques, but really drilling in the basics of what it means to be a racer. I feel like Smokey does a good job at breaking down McQueen's bloated ego though, reminding him that he's old now and isn't what he used to be.
Drafting? I've never had to do that.
Yeah, that's when you were fast. Now you're slow.
And old.
And rickety.
And dilapidated.
Okay, I get it.
But then comes the final training race. Although McQueen tries his hardest to win this one as well, he ends up losing to Ramirez. And, well, there goes his confidence. But alas, the race must go on. To Florida, all eyes are on McQueen. Well, at least all the old guys. The new guys, well, they're also sort of on McQueen, just a bit more disrespectfully, I guess.
She's not a fan, Storm.
Oh, hey there, champ. I heard you're selling mud flaps after today. Is that true? Hey, you put me down for the first case, okay?
Now we finally roll into the final race, with McQueen starting dead last because he missed the qualifiers. Tense music starts playing as well, and it's not looking good for McQueen. With Smokey's final words of encouragement, McQueen's off. I mean, I guess it does make sense that McQueen can swerve his way through at least the first few rookies. Experience does beat raw talent at first. As a presenter put it,
considering he started dead last, I don't think he's doing half bad out there.
While McQueen's racing his heart out to get Storm, Sterling tells off Ramirez because she's the only trainer and I guess needs to get back to her job at the facility. Sterling comes off really harsh in these scenes, and I guess it makes you feel bad for Ramirez, as annoying as she is. But then Sterling goes ahead and says the magic words.
You are a trainer, remember? Not a racer.
McQueen suddenly gets an epiphany as well and wants Ramirez back for his master plan. Ramirez is gonna race instead of McQueen. I remember when I was watching this scene back in the day as a kid and I definitely felt annoyed or even frustrated. Why was McQueen not racing anymore? This was his last chance and he could have seized it and saved the day again. But as I watch it again, it's actually pretty mature of McQueen to come up with a decision like that, to give up his ego and recognize the skills that Ramirez possesses. And well, Ramirez is in the race now instead of McQueen, with McQueen's, weird references, to put it lightly.
Tell her she's on a beach and all the little crabbies have gone night-night.
No.
Ramirez gets her head into the race and starts picking up some speed. However, Storm still maintains a solid lead until he decides to trash-talk Ramirez for a bit. Which, honestly, was a pretty solid scene, not gonna lie.
Hey, costume girl! You know, at first I thought you were down here because your GPS was broken.
Don't listen to him, Cruz.
You look good. It's important to look the part. You can't have everyone thinking that you don't deserve to be here.
He's trying to get in your head.
They don't need to know what you and I already do. That you can play dress up all you want, but you'll never be one of us.
McQueen, talking about how Ramirez actually got into Storm's head instead of Storm trying to get into Ramirez's, was actually a really good way of turning a bad situation to a good one. And honestly, McQueen wasn't even telling any lies.
Well, I don't think so. No!
Cruz, get out of there!
You don't belong on this track!
And well, this scene was pretty cool. Ramirez pulled the old Doc Hudson on Storm, I guess proving that sometimes old tricks work as well, because, well, they always did. This bit from Sterling at the end, well, I mean, I guess it does look pretty bad. He plays into his profit-focused business character really well, and I guess that's on brand. And then Tex rolls in like nothing ever happened and straight up just buys Ramirez off Rusty's like it's nothing. Bringing it back to where it all started in the final scene honestly just makes me feel something every single time. Sure, it isn't Violet Evergarden, it isn't Your Name, nor is it anything that emotional, but that massive wave of nostalgia just hits kind of different. At the end of the day, Cars 3 is a children's film. It's a kids' movie made for kids, but there's just some part of me that thinks this isn't some trend-chasing rubbish knockoff film made for kids of that era, but was made for kids who watched the original Cars. The 5-year-old kids who watched the first Cars film, who are now 14 or 15. The kids who grew up and were getting out of that phase of Disney films. And in a way, I felt like Cars 3 summarized that feeling perfectly. In its own way, it was a film about getting older, realizing you can't stay a kid forever, can't hold on to the same ideals, and can't just believe in yourself for the rest of your life that you're gonna solve every problem you encounter. Because, well, time passes, people grow up. The environment changes, and well, if you don't, you're just gonna be left behind. I think McQueen represented that sentiment perfectly. As the kids who watched McQueen go from rookie to a world champion, it was almost too perfect to see him retire just around the same time as we retired from that age, from idolizing fictional race cars, handing that era of childhood naivety to the next generation of kids. Sure, the retirement felt sad. At the time, I sure wasn't too happy about that ending. But in hindsight, I guess it was what we needed. We had to grow up at some stage, and I guess Cars 3 might not have been what we wanted at the time, but was definitely what we needed to round it all off. With all that being said, I think that maybe, just maybe, Cars 3 is a goddamn masterpiece.
Hope you got your drip pan.
Got my drip pan and I'm taking my nap.
Bring it on, old man.
Luigi?
Go!